Today on Samcraft, we're going to be talking about the laser you see over my shoulder. This is the ComMarker Omni 1 UV Galvo laser, the newest one to hit Samcraft's shop, and we're going to put it through some paces in today's video. Hey guys, my name is Sam and welcome back to Samcraft. That's right, today's video is going to be showing off the ComMarker Omni 1. It is a UV laser, which is different from other lasers you may be familiar with, and that means that it uses a different wavelength laser to get engravings and cuttings on different material. Really quick to talk about assembly and unboxing, there was nothing fantastic. Everything was packaged good, it arrived safe and sound, and assembly was very straightforward. The included manual from ComMarker covered everything, gave me all the info I needed, and we were good to go. After you have your laser assembled, you need to go through the steps. For me, it was with light burn, but if you use EasyCAD, same thing applies. You need to go through the steps to correct and calibrate and set up your lens correctly. What I mean by that is whenever you tell your software that you want a square that measures 100 millimeters in each direction, that what gets output through your laser is a square that measures 100 millimeters in each direction. To be honest, this is a process that takes some time. It probably took me an hour or two to run through all of this. It is a necessary evil. It is not something that is unique to ComMarker. I've had to do this on all my lasers, with the exception of X-Tool because its own little ecosystem is where it lives. But any other machine that uses Lightburn, this is something you gotta do. So I'll put links to Lightburn's official videos down below, which I used and I watched and took step by step to get my machine set up. Once your machine is all set up, the next thing that I would suggest doing is exactly what I did and run some laser test files. So as this machine is sold and advertised with this lens that's on it, it's supposed to have a working size of 150 millimeters by 150 millimeters. What I always like to do is to test that. So I've developed a file and I'll put a link to this one for free down below if you want to download it for Lightburn. It's just basically squares that start at 150 millimeters and then step down in 5 millimeter increments and get smaller as they go. What this gives me is a true visual representation and a way of testing the output to see, am I really getting that size? Does my laser have some weird anomalies? Has it been oversold or advertised to be bigger than it really can do? And stuff like that. In my case, that test revealed that I really have a true 100%, you can count on every corner being engraved, size of 110 millimeters by 110 millimeters. It would hit the 150 millimeters on most area, but the corners got cut off. So for me in my head, I have it locked down that this one only does 110 by 110 for me, with the lens that's installed. You can get other lenses from ComMarker that will change that, but going with what's installed, that's what I had. After running through that step file to find what size I could really expect, I then got a piece of glass. In my case, I bought a photo frame from the dollar store and just took the glass out of it. I set it up on some machinist 1-2-3 blocks and then performed a solid square engraving test. The reason I did this is to check for any kind of dead spots, weak areas, or any other anomalies with the lens or the laser itself so that I know, first of all, do I have a good machine? Is it solid? Is it good? Or do I have problems? And then second, just as a verification, I'll know it's engraving good on this. And so later down the road, if I have issues, I don't have to worry about is the laser or the lens the problem because I checked those to begin with. So at this point in reality, I will have already spent probably 3 hours with this machine going through the lens corrections and the tests. So now we can advance to our next fun of actually doing some engraving tests. At least for this video, it's gonna be the fun thing to see. So let's go ahead and roll some footage of me doing engraving tests, and then I'll talk to you about the different ones I did as they run as well. So first things first, I want to let you know that what you're seeing me apply and install on this machine doesn't come from ComMarker. This is a product that I develop and sell myself. I call it a jig base plate adapter, And what it's going to allow me to do is to use my jigs and get engraving on objects so much quicker and easier, especially for the video, but also for any kind of batch production and everyday uses. The first thing I wanna go through is the easy ones, right? We're talking about anodized aluminum, metal business cards, a metal wallet, and stuff like that. These are surfaces that are really easy to engrave by most lasers out there. Even your cheapest blue light diode lasers can handle these materials. So showing that it can be done with a UV is just, yes, checking that box, but it doesn't fall into the ooh-ah spectrum of UV lasers themselves. However, it is good to show you guys that this one machine will also do these materials. With the metal out of the way, the next thing I want to show you guys is laserable leatherette, or fake leather, that is designed and made to be used with laser engravers to be safe, but also give you a nice contrast. I have a drink coaster here to show you that engraved very easily, nice and quick, no problems there. And then also some patches, like if you do hat patches, any kind of apparel, those also are a product that's easy to do. And like you see here, a piece of cake to engrave. Anytime that I've seen online groups where people are trying to do laserable leatherette engraving and they have issues, most of the time it's because they were going too hot or too slow. Laser engraving, this kind of material is super easy to do. You don't need a lot of power, you don't need low speeds, and so usually that's the issue I see. Now I wanna take you guys on a little bit of deviation into the land of can't be done by fiber, and that is wood or organic materials such as wood, leaves, and other things like that. What you're seeing here is a regular square wooden coaster. It is nothing fancy. But what you are really seeing is this machine engraving that wood with zero charring, zero problems, and doing it pretty as you please. If you've never used a fiber laser, this is a material that you can't use with infrared light. So your fiber lasers, anything that is IR, most of the machines that are advertised or sold as metal marking machines or metal engraving, if they're using that infrared light wavelength, you're not going to get these results. This is something that is unique and special to UV lasers and is definitely a benefit for UV, because now we have not only all the materials of your fiber realm, but now we're stepping into unique or crossing over to diode and CO2 realm, still with just this one machine. Along with the wooden coaster, of course you can do wooden keychains, and they are a piece of cake to do. Honestly, this one that I'm showing you, I probably went a little too slow. I should not have engraved it as hot as I did, but hey, that's the cool thing, right? 5 watts of UV laser. Again, you may think 5 watts is little. It had no problem engraving this wooden keychain too deep. So that's great. I could have went even faster to get the job done quicker and still had great results. All right, swapping out my jig base plate and installing my drinkware jig, we can get into some, well, tricky waters. So UV laser will engrave glass perfectly. It does not need any kind of wet sanding afterwards. You don't need to pre-treat anything. It engraves glass pretty as you please in a surface finish similar to sandblasting. That is a really great thing about UV lasers. However, probably my technique, and this is user error, I really struggled to get consistent good engravings on glass. I would have to run my job multiple times, adjusting the focus of my laser up and down to account for the curvature of the object, but also to account for, I couldn't explain it other than just internal weirdness of the glass. So I tried glasses from a couple of different sources, some as cheap as the dollar store, others as more expensive as probably shouldn't have taken it out of the kitchen, but I kind of had the same result across all of them. I know for a fact UV lasers do engrave glass, and there are a ton of people out there making bank doing businesses with the machine engraving their glass. So again, I think this is me being uneducated as far as the best technique or application and not an instance of the machine. No doubt more practice on my part will give me better results, because when it worked great. I just couldn't figure out how to get it to work 100% of the time. But now when it came to powder coat, so my tumblers or things like that, this machine had no problem at all ablating, blowing through, or engraving off that powder coated paint, revealing the stainless steel below. I didn't really have any focus issues. I didn't really have the problems like I did with glassware. So again, that's why I think that glass was Sam and not the machine, because as you're seeing here, it engraved the tumblers and the stainless steel drinkware without any problems at all. To jump off to a little side quest, what you're seeing here is a drinkware jig that is fixed. And so I think sometimes people may wonder, what is the point of this versus using a rotary? The point is to get your engravings for smaller logos, smaller things, when you don't need to wrap them around the circumference of your object. So in my case, as I do this large Samcraft brand, it's really riding on the top of that cylinder. It's not really wrapping over as much. That is a proper use and a great example of how a fixed drinkware jig like I've got works great in this application. Now, if I wanted to take that same Samcraft brand, rotate it 90 degrees and wrap it around, I would quickly be out of the scope and feasibility of a fixed jig giving me that outcome. I would need to get a rotary, which ComMarker does offer rotaries, chuck it up and do it that way. Jumping out of jig land and into random things from Sam's shop, I found a mirror tea light or candle holder. I think that's what this thing is. Basically, it's a mirror, and I wanted to see, how well does this do engraving the top or the front of a mirror? I've seen plenty of examples of lasers engraving the back of a mirror to give you that kind of result, but I was curious to see how it would react on the top. Honestly, it did perfect. I just chucked it up here on the laser. I used some of my fence jigs to hold it in place in case I wanted to swap it around or otherwise make sure I didn't bump it and let the machine go. Honestly, I think my settings were a little bit slow for this. I was engraving at 80 millimeters per second, so this one took a while, but the outcome was perfect. I didn't have to do any kind of cleanup work. I just let this run at its normal crosshatch engraving, and we were done. And then just like with the glass cups, the glass engraving outcome with this mirror is just as good. I don't have to do any kind of post-treatment, no wet sanding, no worries about glass shards or burrs with any kind of customers' fingers or my own. It's just ready to go right out of the laser. And again, it's a benefit of UV. The last thing I will do is also another huge world that a UV laser will open up for you, and that is plastic. Now, I would be remiss if I didn't give you this disclaimer. Be careful engraving plastics. Some of them have PVC in it. Some of them have other problem components in it that if you engrave it, you might really hurt yourself. So do your research, make sure what you're engraving is safe. Always use your fume extraction regardless of what you run, and don't die. That being said, what you're seeing me load up here are some super cheap plant markers I picked up from the craft store. I'm just holding it down with my machinist 1-2-3 block so it doesn't move around. And one pass, good and done, we have engraved plastic. The UV laser is what is known as a cool laser, as in it looks cool, but it also engraves cool. So I didn't melt the plastic, I didn't deform the plastic, I just marked it. No problem, it didn't deform it, no warping, perfect. That is a benefit of UV. I would be willing to say that a large majority of consumer objects that are plastic that have any kind of labeling, branding, text, or anything on them might be done with UV laser. At least it gives me that impression as I see the outcome on plastic. Well, there you go, guys. There's a look at the ComMarker Omni 1 UV laser. I really have no complaints with this machine. I've had it for about a month and a half, almost 2 months at this point, and it's been working great for me. The only thing I could say that is a negative is that the advertised working size of 150 millimeter square didn't end up being what I had in reality, at least not for that entire square 100%. That negative aside, this machine is great. It has a wonderful height of range for working. You can get really tall objects under there. It has the electric lift, which is great. And I just don't have any complaints. So this is a good machine, just like I know ComMarker has been. I have a fiber laser from them that's over 2 years old, still rocking and rolling just as good as day one. And I think they do build good machines. Well, guys, hopefully this video was helpful for you. Whether this was your first video introduction to a UV laser and its capabilities, or I'm just another one in your binge watch episode as you try to get more informed to make a decision, which is a good thing to do. Remember, I'll put some links down below to some other YouTubers that have made videos on this machine that I have also watched and enjoyed that I really think is gonna help you too. If you guys got any questions or comments, feel free to leave them down below. Otherwise, thanks for watching as always, and I'll see you guys next time in the workshop.